Thank you very much and good morning to everybody. I'm afraid that this lecture will be the most mathematical one, but I try to keep it somehow realistic and simple enough. The topic for this lesson or lecture is perpendicularity. It is one of the oldest concepts in mathematics, and one might assume that it's somehow so familiar to everyone who have studied mathematics in school that there's nothing more to tell about it. We all know what it really means, but perhaps it may provide some new light about mathematical thinking and how mathematics evolves. In this lecture, I shall focus on perpendicularity, but it will turn out that I have to speak a few words about parallelism too. Word perpendicular is used in several meanings in mathematics, but also outside mathematics. And for instance, George Bernard Shaw has somewhere said that dancing is a perpendicular expression of a horizontal desire. This is clearly something else than mathematics, but we see here the word perpendicular. A little more recent phrase or citate, which I found on internet, is from Peter Demonis. And it's about doing business or developing business-oriented thinking. Companies have too many experts who block innovations. True innovations really comes from perpendicular thinking. And then I found another example of way of using this word. And if we look at these three examples at the same time, it seems that a word perpendicular means something doing in a different way, or perhaps disagreeing with an usual thinking. Actually, in YouTube, we can find another example how perpendicular occurs in our real life. And we can watch this video. It's about 3 minutes long, so let's see what happens.
Thank you. right. We saw that. Should I here? This okay? Yes, thank you. Okay, many kind of elements can be perpendicular, but somehow the concept of perpendicular in this video was related to the angle of, well, orthogonal angle or angle which measures 90 degrees. But actually, the way perpendicular word is used in these phrases must mean something else. And next we make an excursion to the world of mathematics and try to ask what this perpendicular word might mean in a language of mathematics. Actually, I have three kind of motives for this presentation. First, if we can find a set of words in mathematics which are so simple that every one of us knows what they mean. It should help us on learning new mathematics or teaching new mathematics, because if we can define new concepts using these words which everybody knows, then it should be more easier to make things understandable. And I ask now whether perpendicularity really is that kind of word. Secondary motivation for this presentation is that real mathematical thinking is ultimately somehow axiomatic thinking. And sometimes school mathematics and university mathematics are seen that they are like different worlds. So can we build bridges between school mathematics and university mathematics so that we could do something mathematical already in school which would teach our kids something essential about mathematical thinking? And third aspect of this lecture is that do we learn mathematics actually so that we have to first know what the terms mean and then we are able to do mathematics? Or is it something like learning to play football, that you just jump to the field, start doing something, and then your understanding about playing football or doing mathematics evolves by doing? So do we have to first know something in order to be able to do, or is it vice versa? So these are my questions. And now if we try to find phenomena or some kind of set of elements where perpendicularity might exist or occur, then we have to first search for properties which perpendicularity must have. And of course, now a natural example of perpendicular things comes from geometry, because we all have learned geometry in school. And most typically, we within mathematics speak about perpendicularity using straight lines. But actually, for instance, symbol of perpendicularity, it is used also in number theory and some other parts of mathematics. And I think if we really had this question as an exercise, quite soon we would notice that everything which is called perpendicular must include the idea of symmetry. Two lines, if A is perpendicular to B, then it is very natural to assume that it's valid also on the other way around. So also B is perpendicular to A. And it's almost as clear that no element can be perpendicular to itself. So if you have perpendicular things, then you have to have two things which are perpendicular. Of course, there can be more than two, but at least it,
it is not possible that one thing is perpendicular to itself. But is there any other properties which are easy to add to this word or this idea of perpendicularity? We may ask whether transitivity holds. And if we try it with straight lines in Euclidean geometry, we notice that it won't work. If A is perpendicular to B and B is perpendicular to C, then A is not perpendicular to C. However, sorry, this is quite dark, but here we should have an implication sign. For some reason, it's not seen here. There seems to be, at least in the world of straight lines in plane, that if we have A perpendicular to B, P perpendicular to C, and C perpendicular to D, then A is once again perpendicular to D. So instead of traditional transitivity, at least in plane, a more extended transitivity may hold. But if we go through the list of all properties of binary relations, there are no other properties which can be said that they are clearly related to the word perpendicular. So one has to conclude that there are actually three alternatives. There are no other properties for perpendicularity in a general sense. Namely, this tree transitivity, or this expanded transitivity, it doesn't hold in space anymore, although it's true in plane. And in non-Euclidean geometry, you can also find examples where none of these transitivity properties holds. But if this is true, then we can say that perpendicularity is really so common that it's almost everywhere, because we can name easily 100 of relations which are symmetric and irreflexive. Among people, we can decide easily or find dozens of different properties which are symmetric and irreflexive. And we may ask now whether is it reasonable to call that all these things are perpendicular with each other. If we agree, then it's a solution. But it can be so that we easily found also relations which, from the second idea, doesn't relate to perpendicularity in any reasonable way. So it's a little bit too general to say that every relation which is symmetric and irreflexive were perpendicular. So this is not a fully satisfactory definition for mathematicians. But now quite perpendicular thinking may occur. It may be an extraordinary idea that we have learned about perpendicularity that it's always two things which define whether they are perpendicular or not. But how about if it's somehow, in a secret way, question of three elements, where the third element is not seen? I mean, can it be so that perpendicularity is a trinary relation, so that this third element is not always seen? For instance, if we consider relativity theory, this world, which we experience as three-dimensional, it's very well explained by using four-dimensional model. So sometimes things can be easier by adding another dimension. But this might be quite revolutionary, and it's not very easy to adopt or accept this idea that a satisfactory definition for two perpendicular elements requires that there's a third element which actually somehow completes this issue. But this is a good example of perpendicular thinking, saying or assume something which is unusual. And it is almost as extraordinary to conclude that actually we don't have one single universal perpendicularity, but there are really different several perpendicular relations. And if we want to know about perpendicularity, then we have to examine all of them. And this third alternative, actually, it sounds quite reasonable, because within mathematics we easily find two examples or two models of mathematical thinking where perpendicularity exists and the elements are quite different, namely straight lines and world of vectors. Because, well, what we can do with the straight lines? We can draw them and we can construct geometrical constructions by using straight lines and normals, but actually this is it. It's quite a static game, but with vectors we can do arithmetics. We can add them, we can multiply them, and actually this is quite different world. So it seems that in school mathematics we speak about perpendicularity in both of these areas of mathematics like they were the same idea, but actually these things are, or they may be, quite different relations. And actually it will turn out that they really are. So, now of these three alternatives, the last one seems to be the most natural or most reasonable starting point. And if we now have a survey about what perpendicularity means, that we can start from the most common or most familiar model, namely straight lines in Euclidean geometry. And now I have collected these properties which I, with my colleagues, have found to establish this relation among Euclidean straight lines as a set of axioms, and this may look quite mathematical, and unfortunately now this laptop seems to lack some fonts, and this box here and here should be the implication sign. And do you all know with what this A, which is upside down, means? It's a symbol for saying for all. So these two axioms, A1 and A2, is to say that for all elements, actually now I noticed that this first circle here in A1, it should be the negative, not an implication, because this axiom is to say that no element is perpendicular to itself. I'm sorry, I didn't know that this sign is not seen here properly. So this is the familiar irreflexivity which already occurred in the slide before. And the second axiom is to say the symmetry thing. The third thing is now this tree transitivity, and unfortunately, once again, I don't know why we don't see here an implication, but it's saying that if A, B, C, and D are perpendicular in this order, then A is perpendicular also to D. But what else? These three things we already found in the previous slides. And it took some time to develop or find the lacking elements. In order to have a sufficiently interesting game, we need to have an axiom saying that there are perpendicular elements. This is only because that if we do not have this as an axiom, then it may be so that our modules where we play the game called perpendicularity, they were empty games. So we need elements, and it's reasonable to assume that for every element there's at least one pairing element which is perpendicular. So giving axioms is giving rules for this game. And the most difficult part for designing this game was inventing this, that we actually need another relation, which we call now parallelism, in order to have some dynamic elements in this game, so that we can make some operations in this game. And from the educational point of view, as much as I have seen teaching mathematics in school, it seems that this point of view is quite often forgotten, that in Euclidean geometry, the idea of the whole thing is that we are somehow creative, and where this creativity comes from. In this game, when we apply an axiomatic approach, it comes from introducing a secondary relation to this primary relation, and to make it so that these two relations are somehow connected to each others. Actually, A5 and A6 are only to say that you can draw a normal, and there are, for two parallel lines, there's a common normal. And of course, designing new mathematical game is a hard work. It takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, and most importantly, a lot of failing before you hit the right point. Yes? Yeah. Once again, we have here a problem. This is an implication arrow. And here we should have that A and B are parallel, and let me see. This is, once again, implication arrow, that for A and B, there's a common normal C. Well, at this point, when we cannot show how many trials failed and how we invented this list of axioms, we can only ask that, how do we know that this is sufficient? Do we need any extra axioms, or are there too many axioms in this list? The only way to know about this thing is try how effective these axiom list works. Can we derive interesting results using this? Or first, is there any model of real elements which would satisfy this list of axioms? If there's no model which satisfies all of these six rules, then it suggests that there may be contradictional rules in this game. If we want to find at least one model which satisfies all of these axioms, it means that these are not this is not a contradictory system, but they are compatible. But another question is that, are they sufficient to produce any interesting results? And therefore, we have to survey some results. And luckily, perhaps for some of us, we do not go to details today. I can only show you some exemplary some examples of results which can be derived within these six axioms. And if we can verify that this secondary relation is already an equivalence relation, it's a quite a strong result. It means that it really works like parallelism in Euclidean geometry. And once again, in theorem 2, we lack two symbols. This should be implication arrow, and the second white box should be negative. And let me see about this third axiom, third theorem. The first white box should be and sign, and the second one here should be an implication. So if we have two assumptions, then we can derive that A and C are perpendicular. These are quite typical results which are proved in traditional geometric education in senior high school in Finland nowadays, in past decades with already in lower secondary school. And actually, there are quite many more other interesting theorems which can be very wide, and they all are compatible with model of Euclidean geometry in plane. Well, after all, this is not very surprising because all of these six axioms were invented by secretly thinking about model of straight lines in plane. But perhaps this is interesting. There are also other completely different models which satisfy these three axioms, and now we enter to a new world in some sense. And if we introduce the one of the simplest one, actually these three axioms, these six axioms, they are valid also in such a simple model which consists of two elements. Now we use symbols 0 and 1 and define this perpendicularity and parallelism by using these two tables. Once again, we perhaps might need more time to really be confirmed that yes, all of these six axioms are valid in these systems. But if you copy these, then you can do it on your own. You quite easily notice that these are valid. And now we can play some semiotics and think whether this model has any meaning or can it be useful for anywhere else. And funny thing is that if we replace, for instance, the symbol 0 with that child on the second slide, and symbol 1 with his mother, and then say that this perpendicularity is a symbol for disagreeing, and this second symbol for agreeing, then we notice that this model is fully compatible with Euclidean geometry, the way we use word perpendicularity in Euclidean geometry, but it describes the way the word perpendicular was used in that phrase or example. So at least perpendicularity in child speech is a really mathematical way of using that word. And actually, this is a mathematical model for arguing. When you disagree or argue with someone else, it's being really in a perpendicular relation with one another. This is somehow amusing. It's something like Hermann Hesse's Glasperlenspiel. So, learning and doing mathematics somewhere else. Well, This is once again more mathematical. I'm sorry for the lack of symbols here, but let's say that in number theory, we can find easily models which also satisfy these six axioms. So from the point of view of teaching mathematics, this may be of some use or interesting in some sense, that we can really speak about perpendicularity within speaking number systems. So this word has a meaning also somewhere else outside geometry. Here we should have in the first black or white box that X and Y are perpendicular if and only if X times Y is less than zero. It can be said another way, X and Y have a different signs. So by multiplying them, we get a negative number. And X and Y are parallel if and only if they have the same sign. Meaning that if we multiply them, then the result is greater than zero. We have to exclude zero from this set so that this rule really works. And this is not only example in the world of real numbers. Actually, it's quite easy to construct several other examples of perpendicular relations using real numbers. Okay, this was quite mathematical, and now it's not so important to understand every detail, but the main idea, or I aimed at showing that outside of traditional way of using word perpendicular, we can find precisely the same meaning for this word, although these elements are completely different. And one of these models also applied if we try to model human speech or human conversation. Agree and disagreeing is really something like being parallel or perpendicular to one another. So at least this, in this sense, it is reasonable to use word perpendicular in an ordinary speech in that sense. And those of you who teach mathematics and geometry may be slightly amused by noticing that actually perpendicularity is not really related so strongly to angle which measures to 90 degrees. Actually, we can find a system of straight lines so that we can define any angle and say that this angle is an angle of orthogonality or perpendicularity. And then we have to adjust then what we mean by word parallel. And this example is developed so that we say that two lines are perpendicular if the angle between them is only 45 degrees. Then parallel lines must be lines which are parallel in the ordinary sense or which are perpendicular in the ordinary sense. So this is an example of showing that in mathematics we really have to make an agreement what we mean by using certain words. We can't not always assume that everyone of us knows what these words mean, because they really can have a different meaning. This is an example of speaking about parallel or perpendicular lines in a different sense, but it works totally in the same way as at an axiomatic level as the ordinary way of using these words. And this is quite a radical idea, that words can have, we can change the meaning of the words and still play the rational game. Okay, this might be a good place to stop, but only shortly. I show you that this story can go on. And I mentioned that another world of perpendicularity in school mathematics, which is different from Euclidean geometry, is a world of vectors. And it refers to algebraic structures of mathematical knowledge. And it's quite surprising that we can also here give a list of axioms, and actually now only 5 axioms are needed so that we can play this perpendicularity game. And another interesting property in this axiom system is that now we don't have to speak about parallelism. If we have as a starting point, an abelian group or a ring, then only 5 axioms are needed for playing perpendicularity game. And here these symbols which are missing is that here first, for every element A which is different from zero, once again, irreflexibility is valid. So here is a negative sign. This is an implication sign. Once again, symmetry is assumed. Once again, we need that we have to have perpendicularity elements so that this won't be an empty game. But the other 2 axioms, they are now axioms which rely on arithmetical or algebraic properties of the space underlying this thinking. So actually we need that this axiom system is, we need to have an abelian group where these axioms can be set. And here we have an implication arrow, meaning that if A and B are perpendicular, then A is perpendicular to the inverse of a B too. And in the last axiom, we have A and B perpendicular, and A and C are perpendicular, then it implies that A is perpendicular also to the sum of B and C. So these 2 axioms are the dynamic axioms, which give us space for creating or playing this game. And these are the basic, more static rules, which, well, establish what perpendicularity is as a static relation. And I only mention that an example where this way of using word perpendicular is reasonable is in number theory, when 2 integers are relatively prime, so they don't have a common divisors except 1, then we can call them perpendicular. And it satisfies these 5 axioms. And actually, this thing has some consequences or interesting results in number theory, but we do not know them all yet. And so it means that although perpendicularity is thousands years old concept in mathematics, even now we do not know about everything about it. So it's still possible to publish new articles about this concept in mathematics, so that they are really academic mathematics. And here are a few examples of these articles. Okay, I skipped 1 slide, or actually 2 slides. I say something about these pedagogical conclusions. Hopefully, what I was able to show, at least at some level, is that this axiomatic approach, which is very often neglected in school because many students seem to be a little afraid of doing axiomatical mathematics. I don't know why. Perhaps it's us teachers who sometimes are also afraid doing axiomatic mathematics. But if we can put our fears aside and try this as a game, then we may be able to know this, that this axiomatic approach, it may help us to find new aspects and even new results about very old concepts. So in a way, this enriches our teaching and thinking about, even about elementary concepts. And the question in the beginning of this lecture was that, do we have to first know the meaning of concepts in order to be able to do mathematics, or do we learn these concepts by doing mathematics? It seems that at least we can gain and collect new conceptual understanding by playing these procedural games. So in a way, it seems that doing mathematics without first understanding why we do it, it can be said, playing mathematical games without first understanding what is the purpose of this game can result that we develop our conceptual understanding by playing these games. But on the other hand, if we look at these games as from the point of view of designer of these games, then it seems that we need quite a deep understanding about the essence of these concepts and the idea where this game must aim at before we are able to set the right rules for these games. So this conceptual procedural dualism, they seem to be intertwined in such a way that they are always both and. We cannot say that we can just jump into playing mathematics and it automatically guarantees that we develop good conceptual understanding. But it doesn't work either in the opposite way. So designing these games may assume quite deep conceptual understanding, but playing these games may develop this deep conceptual understanding. Okay, thank you for your for listening and seeing this lecture.